are talking about entrepreneurship and innovation to particularly people from Gujarat is like preaching to the choir. I mean, I know that Gujaratis are very innovative, very entrepreneurial, and but I will tell you, particularly when it comes to the high-tech innovation, I personally think that our educational institutions are not doing enough. While people are very innovative, people want to do many things, particularly the students, the undergraduate students and even the postgraduate students, while they want to do many things, but I think the support they receive from their universities, the support they receive from their educational institutions, I think there is a lot more that is desired, and there is a lot more the institutions can do. And I think my talk is more from, you know, that point of view. As an educational institution, what can we do? And at IIT Delhi, for example, in the last 4 years, now we have been doing a variety of things, more from the point of converting our students from job seekers to job providers. I think at the end of the day, that needs to become our mantra. So we need to produce job providers, because if everybody comes out of our campuses and starts looking for a job, I don't think the jobs are going to, you know, fall from the sky. I think our students, our leaders, or our, you know, the people coming out of our institutions, they are the ones, you know, even the faculty, they are the ones who also need to take up this role of job providers. And that is where I will, you know, talk about. If you look at the COVID, I think one thing that COVID has definitely done is it has impacted our educational institutions in multiple ways. One thing is, of course, we are all now closed down. And in March, IIT Delhi, we closed down. And so every institution is now suddenly dealing with a crisis. We really don't know, you know, how to prepare for it. We did not even have enough time to prepare for anything. Suddenly, we all moved to online kind of a thing. But there are, you know, there is a silver lining, otherwise in a very gloomy kind of a scenario. You know, one thing that has definitely happened is the online offerings. At IIT Delhi, you know, we recently did a survey. Almost like 70% of faculty members never taught anything live online. They would have recorded some lectures and posted them, but they never really taught any class online kind of a thing. And that is 70%. And all of a sudden, when we told them, you know, now you start going live and start delivering lectures, they did not even know where to start, what programs to use, how to behave when you are in front of a camera. I think, you know, many of our finest teachers in the classroom may not become equally good teachers when they are online. So therefore, imparting those skills to faculty members, exposing them to the nuances of, you know, what is online teaching, how to behave differently when you are, you know, recording a lecture. I think, you know, some of these things we were never really taught. We never had time to even look at some of that. But all of that we had to pick up in a matter of a couple of weeks and start doing things. I think that way, you know, within a matter of a month from IIT Delhi, there were at least 400 lectures, you know, telecast live, and that was, you know, without any kind of a preparation. And even the one thing which will also change now because of COVID is, I think now that those barriers are broken, now that people are comfortable, you know, delivering lectures on Zoom and other kind of platforms, I think the scale of online offerings will improve or will increase. Even at IIT Delhi now, our last Senate meeting, we approved a certificate programs now. Now IIT Delhi will be offering certificate programs in very advanced areas like AI, data sciences kind of areas, where you know, anyone can register with minimum qualifications. But to get a certificate from IIT Delhi, you need to, you know, pass an exam. That will also be an online exam, a proctored kind of an examination. So we are now going to offer more and more online programs, and that, you know, otherwise would have been difficult to pass in our Senates. But now IIT Delhi will give online certificates where 5,000 people can take some of these courses now. And we are also for the first time joining hands with companies in the education space. For example, there are many companies now like, you know, the Upgrad or Coursera, or there are so many, at least a half a dozen or even more than closely a dozen such companies now which are in the education space. Now we have been discussing with them, and we have now, with their help, with them as partners, IIT Delhi will be offering these certificate programs. That's one good thing that has happened now. Therefore, the scale of online offerings will improve.
Now, when the students come back, at some point we will have to get the students back to our campuses. One thing that will also happen is this flipped classrooms. Now that we are all used to, you know, taking online lectures, now you don't have to go to the classroom and 8 to 9 you have to teach engineering mechanics, 9 to 10 you have to teach chemistry, 10 to 11 you have to teach physics. I think who says that it should be that way? Now all these lecture material, because now they are available in the digital form, students can take these lectures in the classroom and take these lectures in their hostel room, and they can come to the classroom only to have a discussion with the instructors. I think that is what I would call, or one would call, the flipped classroom kind of an approach, where the instruction happens online, but the discussions happen in the classroom. So that is one thing which you will see happening more and more. And even now for the coming semester, the semester which is starting in September, we realize that there are at least 10% of IIT Delhi students who don't have proper internet connectivity. Now we plan to get those students back to the campus, you know, ask them to stay in the hostels, and they will take lectures from their hostel rooms. The remaining 90% of students will take lectures from their rooms, from their houses, wherever they are, and the lectures will be delivered to their homes. And those who don't have proper internet connectivity, they can come to the hostel, stay here, and take these lectures. So that sort of a model will happen now for the coming semester. And that is one thing which we have no choice right now. The blended learning, where, you know, a combination of digital and the classroom kind of learning, I think these two things will come together, and a hybrid kind of an approach is what we will follow as we go forward. And so therefore, when you talk about education, one thing you will definitely see is the more and more online programs from particularly IITs and many universities for that matter, more flipped classroom kind of approaches, more blended learning kind of models. I think that is something that will happen when it comes to the education space. And when you talk about the research, now one thing that has happened is, in our institutions, we have been conducting research. We have been, you know, the end goal of all research is publishing a paper. I think, you know, once you publish a paper, everything seems to be all right. And if you ask, you know, how good a researcher is, we usually go to the Google Scholar, look at how many papers a person has published, and look at the citations, and we think everything is fine now, kind of a thing. But I think now the community or the society expects us to do more than that. Research doesn't mean any longer just publishing papers. And that is again the place where we are looking at, you know, what else has changed because of COVID. You know, the one thing which has changed is the relevance of our research. Now, when you are talking about research now, the research now will become relevant because, you know, in the COVID times, for example, now at IIT Delhi, when we closed down the institute in March, you know, we told our faculty and students, anyone who wants to, you know, continue to work in the COVID area, or anyone who wants to reorient their research to work on the COVID problem. When I say COVID problem research, it can be prevention technologies, it can be treatment technologies, it can be detection technologies. So any researcher who has got ideas to work around any of these aspects of COVID, we said institute will open their laboratories, will ensure that they get all financial support and other logistic support from the institute. Their students can stay back. So we made that offer to the faculty members. At least 20 groups came forward. They said that, you know, they can orient their research for solving the COVID problem. We allowed them. Now at IIT Delhi, there are at least 100 people right now, while the rest of the institute has closed down. Now these 100 people are going to the lab every day, working day and night, and working on the COVID problem. And that is what I will show you, you know, in the subsequent slides, you know, how much we have been able to accomplish with these 100 people working on one single problem, which is COVID. I think, and then also it's relevant because if you don't work on COVID now, you know, when will you really work on that? I mean, 2 years from now, if you say, I will do research on COVID, nobody would be interested. And it is the time now to actually, you know, do research on COVID, and then do also a delivery part of it, because even if you do a great research on COVID right now, if that research doesn't help the society, you know, it's of no use for anybody. And even if you say that I will do research, but my results will be out 2 years from now, until that time I cannot do anything with my research, you know, that also is not going to take us anywhere. Therefore, this delivery part of it is also very important, and delivering these solutions to society in a matter of weeks to months, you know, to address the COVID problem is also something that has changed. And even after COVID ends, I can tell you more and more faculty members you know, now we'll start to work on problems which are of relevance to the society. And we'll also, because now that we have figured out how to deliver these research results to the society, now the delivery part of it is also will get enough of attention. So therefore, while R&D people call research and development, I would call R&D as relevance and delivery. So that is one thing that the COVID situation has changed us for us now, for us in the country. And that is one thing, you know, where we have now, you know, got a foothold as to how to do relevant research, how to deliver it to the society. So that has also happened on a larger scale. Therefore, this is also one good thing that has happened. Now, the third aspect of any educational institution is the innovation. So the innovation is taking things to the people. Eventually, at the end of the day, you have delivered a technology. Have people been using, you know, what you have delivered, basically? So again, when it comes to innovation, the affordable innovation, because if I develop a COVID detection kit, right, if that COVID detection kit costs me, let's say, 4,000 rupees per test, nobody is interested in that. Now, can I develop the same, deliver the same COVID detection in a matter of 100 rupees, 200 rupees? Then the whole world will stand up and take notice. Therefore, making your innovation affordable, making it also accessible. You might deliver a COVID detection kit, but if that kit is available in small numbers, if you are not able to scale up, you know, the research outcome, then it's again not of any use. So therefore, can we put out 1 million COVID detection kits at a rate of, let us say, you know, 300 rupees per test? I think that is what I would call affordable and accessible. That is the need of the day, you know, today when it comes to COVID. Therefore, when it comes to innovation, the affordable and accessible are becoming the most important aspects right now. So this is what has changed now. And this is what we are able to, in a way, demonstrate during these COVID times. And this, I would believe, we will continue to work on. And much of our research now will start to become more relevant to the society. And we will all, since we have already figured out as part of the COVID, you know, how to deliver these things to the society, how to scale up, I think that experience also is going to help us in a very significant way. And taking it forward in the post-COVID scenario, I think I would think that we are in a self-discovery mode. When we closed down IIT Delhi, you know, in the month of March, we did not really know, you know, what all we can do as an educational institution to address the COVID problem. But I threw open a challenge to our faculty, said that, you know, can you do something now to solve the problem? And I was amazed myself to see the kind of response I got from our faculty and students, the kind of innovation they have been able to come up with. This I would call the self-discovery kind of a thing. Even I did not expect that so many people would come forward and do so many great things in such a short time. So that is what is the self-discovery that has definitely happened at IIT Delhi. The relevance and delivery, I think this is going to become the mainstay of technology research in IITs, and definitely so at IIT Delhi. A disruption is waiting to happen. Now that we have broken the barriers and fears of online education, now IIT Delhi has taken a very bold step of offering certificate programs to 5,000 people who will register for these programs. I think that is also something, you know, that has definitely taken place. Otherwise, the IIT model, you know, was also very different. IIT model was you conduct the toughest examinations of the world and you take in a few people, and these people get the high quality training, and eventually all of them will pass out and enter the society. So you take in very few people to all these examinations, and that was the model. But so therefore you have a huge entry barrier to get into IITs, but you already hardly have any exit barrier. So that entry barrier is so huge that only a few can get into the IIT system. What has definitely now, what will change now is this education will scaled up, will get scaled up, the quality education will get scaled up. As a result, you will see, you know, entering the IIT system for taking these courses, there won't be any barrier. But to get that certificate, you will have a barrier. So you can enter easily. You take all these programs which are available online, you pass a test, and then you get a certificate from IIT Delhi. And we are even thinking of giving credits to people who take these online courses. If they accumulate certain number of courses, we might even be able to give a diploma at some point. And who knows, in the future, IITs can even give degrees, you know, once people accumulate certain number of credits. I think that is something that has changed now, you know, because of COVID, because those barriers and fears are all broken by the current pandemic. And also, if you look at the technology, incorporation into our teaching and all of that, other than PowerPoint kind of a thing, I don't think in the classrooms we have really imbibed any new technology. But now, thanks to what is happening today, you will see that we are going beyond PowerPoints, and we will start to use more and more technology in our classrooms, whether it is the flipped classroom approaches or the blended learning kind of model. So there are a lot of things that will also happen in that space, and also the scale up of quality education, as I said, through the certificate programs, online programs, you will see more and more of this happening. IIT Madras has already announced a bachelor's program, BSc program in data sciences, which is going to be completely online. IIT Delhi is announcing now in the next 1 month a large number of certificate programs in very advanced areas. I think that is one thing that has happened now, and that is a good thing for the country in a way. Now, when I say the self-discovery part of it in COVID times, when it comes to research, suddenly a lot of research, IIT Delhi has 600 faculty, and you will find 600 faculty working on 500 problems. Now, when you look at it, everybody is doing a little bit of it. Everybody is publishing some papers. But when you look at the collective effort, it all looks very scattered and very diffuse kind of a thing. But because of COVID, now those 100 people working on one single topic, COVID, which is very relevant for the country. And there is also a focus now to the research that we are doing. There is a team spirit. Now, because of COVID, if somebody in textile department develops a mask and he or she applies a certain coating to this mask, and the person goes to a biology department and then tells them, can I test this coating for antiviral properties, antimicrobial properties? That is happening on a daily basis right now. So that kind of a team spirit has come into the system. There is an urgency. Like I said, you might develop a solution to the COVID, whether it is prevention, treatment, or detection, but it has to get out into the society in a matter of days to weeks now. So there is that urgency. And there is also the national spirit. Finally, if you are able to provide a solution to the society, there is a satisfaction of doing something for the nation. So that feeling is also there. The delivery is also very important. You might have developed a great quality mask, which is very low cost, but unless I am able to produce them in 1 million kind of pieces, nobody will really take notice of it. Therefore, the delivery and scale up is important, and even the industry connect. And once the COVID happened, we started contacting many industries for their support, and we received support from at least a dozen industries, and they have funded quite significantly many of these research activities. And thanks to all of these, we are able to now, in fact, in the next few days, we will be announcing a RT-PCR test kit, CoroSure, and this will be launched by the minister, and we are targeting a price of 399 rupees. Now, you will be able to do RT-PCR test from IIT Delhi at a cost of 399 per test. I think that is something which will come, and many of these startups now have been able to put out these masks, and there are a lot of treatment-related research which is happening right now. If you go to the IIT Delhi webpage, you will find a lot of research where we are looking at the effectiveness of existing medicines and newer medicines and even the traditional medicines. How do they help prevent the COVID spread? For example, ashwagandha, we looked at scientifically how ashwagandha is effective in arresting the spread of this virus. We even looked at some of the tea extracts, how tea extracts can also help build immunity in people. So a lot of that research also happened. Complete PPE kits we were able to put out at a very low cost, which are very comfortable for the medical doctors. And the coverage, now these guys were able to sell almost like a million masks in the last few weeks alone at a price of 45 rupees. 45 rupees for an N95 equivalent mask. So that was what they were able to develop with antimicrobial coatings and antiviral coatings and all of that. So this is the innovation that has taken place now in a matter of the last 3 months alone. So we were starting from March onwards, people started orienting their work towards COVID, and we have been able to achieve so much in such a short time. And how did all this happen? I mean, Rome is not built in a day. So if it is not IIT Delhi, and if you are doing this kind of a research at any other place, I think you would have faced many hurdles, many things along the way, many steps that you would have needed to circumvent along the way. But I think IIT Delhi, there is an entrepreneurial ecosystem on the campus, and that is something we need to create at many institutions now. At IIT Delhi, if you look at it, you know, how does the entrepreneurship ecosystem actually gets built, is built in the system? Now, when the students enter, I just took the example of the BTech students here, but the same thing applies for the masters and even the PhD students. In fact, we have an incubator for the PhD students at IIT Delhi, and any student of the campus can actually make use of these facilities available on the campus. So we're starting from their first year onwards, we actually teach them courses to excite these new students on innovation and entrepreneurship. And then we also give them a design innovation summer project very early on in their career. We have a discover and learn program where students can choose a problem. And this is actually called 1-2-3-4, which means that a first year student, second year, third year, and a fourth year student come together and they identify a problem which has a society relevance. And then they work as a team. When the final year student graduates, a first year student enters. That way, these are seen as relay projects. So over a period of time, many of these projects become prototypes and products. And then with the IP that they keep protecting, they will be able to start a company subsequently. So this is a program we started about 2.5 years ago. Now it's a very popular program on the campus where students work in groups. When one student goes out in the final year, another student enters in the first year, and that way the projects continue without any kind of an interruption. And that way students get to learn how to work as a team, how to work on a problem of societal relevance, how to develop a prototype, and all that funding comes from the institute. We also started many immersion programs because one of the challenges is many of these students don't really know what are the problems in the society. Therefore, you need to provide them opportunities to know about problems. We have these immersion programs where our students can go to hospitals, stay with a doctor for a couple of months in the summer, understand how medicine is practiced in this country and what are the diagnostic technologies required, what is that that the doctors require. In fact, we even started a village internship program where our students can go to remote areas, stay there during the summer, and then they can try to understand, for example, how farmers do their farming and what are the challenges in the current agricultural sector. And so these are the immersion programs that we run where students get to know the problems, and once they know the problems, they can make use of all of these schemes on the campus to develop solutions to those problems. And then we have the student startup action plan, and here again all the funding comes from the institute. And at the final year, we even have a deferred placement option. We tell our students that if you want to start a company after graduation, you can go ahead and do that. And if it succeeds, anyway, they don't have to come back to the campus. But if you fail after a couple of years, you can come back to the campus, use the placement opportunities available for the students and find a job. So we provide that cushion for the students so that they can take risk with their careers. And this deferred placement option every year is availed by many students. So they try out different things, startups, and if they succeed, they don't have to come back. But if things don't work out for any reason, they can come back and find a job using the campus placement. And again, we have this semester break for startup. If any student says that for 1 year, I want to take a break and I want to build my company, come back and complete my degree, IIT allows that right now. And we also have an entrepreneurship minor, a minor degree program for entrepreneurship. In this minor program, which is now a very popular program on the campus, they can formally take about six to seven courses in all aspects related to entrepreneurship, starting from finance to business plan writing and all of that, which is offered by our management school and other departments. And they can take these courses and become trained for doing entrepreneurship. So this is a very formal way we introduce our students to entrepreneurship. And then there are many innovation programs and many courses. I think this is the ecosystem that we have built at IIT Delhi that is now yielding the results. If you actually see the number of startups coming from IIT Delhi, we now are doing pretty well. In fact, in the world, in terms of unicorn founders, the $1 billion valued companies from any university, if you see, IIT Delhi is ranked at the sixth position in the world in terms of unicorn founders. That is what IIT Delhi does. And in terms of number of startups, IIT Delhi is way ahead of any other institution in the country. And that has happened because from first year onwards, students are exposed to what is entrepreneurship and all of that. And many alumni come back and help them in doing some of that. And we also have a society, this is a Section 8 company on the campus called FITT, Foundation for Innovation and Technology Transfer. This is a business incubator of IIT Delhi. Any student who wants to start a company, any faculty member who wants to start a company, this is the first stop. They go here to FITT, and that is where they can get all the mentorship and space and even some funds for starting their company. They operate this technology business incubator. But one thing I must tell you, IIT Delhi incubator is an open incubator. It is not just meant for IIT Delhi students or faculty or alumni. It is open for everyone. So if you have a great idea, you should just come and pitch it to us. And if the FITT team, we have a team to screen those ideas. If they like your idea, we will provide you all the support needed for you to start your company. So therefore, keep in mind that the IIT Delhi incubator is an open incubator. Whatever I have mentioned, many of these schemes you can avail, even if you are not a student of IIT Delhi. So we also have this biotechnology business incubation facility. We work with Boeing and the Ministry of Electronics very closely on the innovation programs. We have multiple ministries and industries supporting us for the incubation program. We also run this Women Entrepreneurship and Empowerment program. The fifth cohort of trainees is now currently underway. Every half yearly, we take at least like 30 women and we train them to become entrepreneurs. The V is a very successful program. You should actually go to the search for V program IIT Delhi. You get all the details. They have a web page and you have information on how to apply and all that. If you are a woman and looking for becoming an entrepreneur, this is an opportunity for you to, get formally introduced to entrepreneurship. Some of our alumni have also set up awards for entrepreneurship and innovation. So these are some of the things that are available. But we also have our own challenges. The current challenges, if you see, we still, while we do many things, there is an absence of a single entity for proactive planning and implementation. At IIT Delhi, we are now looking at creating a school for entrepreneurship. It is a school for entrepreneurship, which in fact our alumni want to create. There are discussions that are taking place right now with some of our alumni who are in the founders of various companies, and they are now asking. In fact, they want to help set up this school of entrepreneurship at IIT Delhi. And once we are able to do that, it will be again a national facility where we'll be able to help more people. And the need for entrepreneurship activities which can scale and sustain. We want to be, starting from 2021, end of 2021, we want to have 100 startups on the campus. But IIT Delhi wants to be involved with at least 1,000 startups at the national level. IIT Delhi, when I say involvement, it can be in multiple ways. You might be connected with us, you may be incubated with us, you may be using our facilities, you may be getting mentorship from the faculty or some technology help. We under those schemes, we want to have at least 1,000 startups to be connected with IIT Delhi. And the mentorship cloud scarceness is what is affecting us. So we want to bring back many of our alumni. We have done very well in the entrepreneurship space, and help them take their help in mentoring all these startups now. With startups with no formal training in entrepreneurship, so we also started the minor degree program in order to address this. And the lack of support for entrepreneurs who start right after the degree program, that is again an issue. Not many deep tech ventures and social enterprises, lack of design, social sciences, management and legal inputs, need next level of design and manufacturing support, less of tech transfer, tech licensing and other exit options, onboarding more faculty for entrepreneurial activities, need to improve exploitation of IP and translational research. So these are all national problems, true of IIT Delhi to some extent. And we have been addressing many of these problems in variety of ways. And as I said, we are now looking at setting up a new school for entrepreneurship to mentor more and more entrepreneurs in the country. And we have started this faculty interdisciplinary research program because to provide solution to a problem, you need multidisciplinary kind of teams. And so that is where we in fact encourage our faculty through very structured programs to work with each other across the disciplines. And we are now in the process of, we have a new school created about 2 years ago for interdisciplinary research. And we have this very interesting program called Faculty Innovation and Research-Driven Entrepreneurship. We are now pushing our faculty to become entrepreneurs because many of them have been conducting research in many topics, and they even have solutions to many problems. So unless we push them to become entrepreneurs, the students wouldn't do that. So therefore, we are now asking our faculty to become entrepreneurs under a scheme called FIRE. Under this scheme, if a faculty member says, I want to become entrepreneur, institute gives them leave up to 3 years, after which 1 year will be a sabbatical, 2 years of lien, and then 3 years of leave one can take. We also give them 50 lakh support, you know, for starting their venture. And under this scheme, now many faculty members, you know, are coming forward to become entrepreneurs. I think this is something which is needed, because that is what will propel the deep tech innovation in the country. When faculty members do that, then the PhD students will get in, and that is how, you know, the more deep tech innovation takes place. We also have this PhD incubator program. PhD here stands for Platform for Harnessing Deep Technologies. So under this program, if you have a deep tech idea, you can write to IIT Delhi. We will support you, and this is again a deep tech incubator. And then we also have many innovation labs. If you want to make use of any of the facilities available at IIT Delhi for any of your research activities or for your entrepreneurship activities, we are very open to that. In fact, we are also creating a prototype manufacturing facility. So any such requirement you may have for accessing any of the high-end facilities available on the campus, write to us, because we are open to helping entrepreneurs in this space, because, you know, some of these facilities are very scarce and they are not available everywhere. Now, in the next 5 minutes, I will just tell you, you know, the with all that ecosystem that exists on the campus, when the COVID problem, struck the country, and we were able to put all of that together, and we also wanted to see how can IIT Delhi contribute to solving the or address the COVID problem at the national level. So we started conducting research, you know, starting from March onwards. Some of them started early. Some of our bio schools knew about the COVID virus way back in January this year. So they started working, researching on the COVID-19 virus. But many others got into this in the month of March when we decided to close down the institute. So our research is in the prevention area, the spreading awareness. For example, there is a Prakriti web-based dashboard at IIT Delhi, multiple PPEs, the sanitization, the detection kits. IIT Delhi detection kit is already approved by ICMR, the only academic institute in the country whose kit is approved now. It is getting into the market pretty soon. The treatment side, we have been doing a lot of computational work to understand the molecular level interactions with the virus, and, you know, developing drugs for solving this problem. So there is a lot of research happening on that. On the prevention side, you know, IIT Delhi uses its own internal sanitizers. Some of our chemistry department, you know, came forward and gave us 50 liters of sanitizer. You know, they were able to do WHO prescribed quality sanitizers in a matter of a few days, and which is what we are using all over. And the touchless kind of dispenser systems, you have these masks, and then the Prakriti website, as I was mentioning, a web-based dashboard for spreading the awareness, which uses, you know, multiple these models for India, which are very specific to India. And then this website is updated on a weekly basis. You can actually go to this website, just search Prakriti on the web. You see in every district of the country how COVID is spreading and what is happening. That is the information you get from IIT Delhi. And then we have this mask, the personal protection equipment, which are all coated with antiviral and antimicrobial coatings. These are all washable kind of masks developed by one of the startups at IIT Delhi. They are called NSafe. Again, you know, and these are all tested. Whatever we develop before we put it out into the society, these are all thoroughly tested in the laboratories. Many of them are tested in the ICMR laboratories. They are all reusable up to 50 times. So these are all available now. And similarly, there are multiple masks with antimicrobial coatings and complete PPE suits we were able to develop. And this is a detection kit, the COVID-19 detection kit, which is approved by ICMR. In the next 3-4 days, we will be launching, one of the licensees will be launching this product. This is, we have given non-exclusive licenses to multiple companies for this. And in terms of equipment, a lot of work happening on the respirators. And we are also doing a lot of research on the COVID medicines. In fact, a couple of press releases have already been put out on the effectiveness of some of the traditional medicines in addressing the COVID problem. IIT Delhi webpage has details on that. And then the treatment strategies, again, we are looking at multiple treatment strategies around the supercomputer facility that we have. In fact, we made available our supercomputer facility free of cost to researchers in the country. We said that if anyone wants to use the IIT Delhi supercomputer facility, which is a 3 petaflop machine right now, so we said it is available and they just need to submit a proposal and we allocate resources for them and they can run those simulations. And we are currently supporting at least 10 projects from outside IIT Delhi worth about 1 crore. If they were to pay for that time, would have cost these projects are worth about 1 crore. And that kind of supercomputer time we are making available to researchers so that they can research on the drugs and other things. So if you look at the post-COVID scenario, we have been able to develop technologies and commercialize them. The one good thing in all of this is the role of startups. 10 years ago, if we were to put out any technology into the society, the only way would have been to work with industries. You develop a technology, you license that technology to an industry, and the industry would work to, you know, put it out into the society. But now that is not the case. If I am a faculty member, if I develop a solution, I go out and start a company within the, because all IITs now allow that. Even UGC now has made plans to for its universities to allow incubation by their faculty. In fact, I was chairing a committee and we also drafted some policies for UGC institute, for all universities in the country and their faculty to become entrepreneurs. And so therefore that is now available. Therefore, you don't have to look at only transfer of technology as a way to commercialize something. You can start your own company. I think for the first time now, we are seeing that the Lakshmi and Saraswati can be together. I think that is a good thing that is happening now in the country. And so that has definitely helped many of our faculty to find solutions and also to commercialize them. And this relevance and delivery, as I said, is going to become the mainstay of technology research in IITs. And we are also launching these online certificate programs. Over 300 online programs, you know, courses we were able to run in a short time. Now it is going to be 600 courses next semester. And the scaling up of quality education in the country with IITs leading the way is also something, you know, that is going to happen on a large scale. So therefore, the institutions have a role to play. I think institutions need to create this immersion program. We need to expose our students and faculty to real world problems. Now they put them in the summers, they can go to hospitals or in the villages or work with farmers. You know, let them get immersed in some project or some problem so that they understand the problem and then come back and then find a solution to that. So we need to create more and more immersion programs. This mentorship is very important. That is where, you know, alumni who have been successful in the as founders, you know, is also very important. So that mentorship is important. The incubation support. Now, once you have a problem, once you are mentored properly, institutions need to have incubators where we can provide them all the kind of support for them to start their company. The financial support is also important. And IIT Delhi, very soon, you know, we are in fact allocating some of our funds which are available in our FITT for equity-based investment. IIT Delhi now, in fact, in the last board meeting of FITT, the Foundation for Innovation and Technology Transfer, our incubator, and now we said they keep their money in the bank, earning some bank interest. We said, why don't you now take out that money and put it or invest it in the startups, you know, using all the strategic kind of investments and all of that. And you know, that I believe is a way to go. So therefore, IIT Delhi will also be now to the FITT. We will be providing financial support, equity-based financial support for any company where the idea is good. This is also something that is going to happen. Scale up on manufacturing is very important because at the lab level or even at a startup level, you might make 10 systems or 20 systems. But if you need to scale up, even the institutional support is also very important for that. And this is again, you know, something we have been able to do because IIT Delhi now has tied up with multiple industries, large industries. So many of these startups now are now interfacing between academia and the industry. So startups are acting as a bridge between academia and industry. So that is also helping the startups in a major way when it comes to manufacturing. So this is one thing that is happening. And even marketing. If you see IIT Delhi webpage, you will see that, you know, almost every week we put out a press release. And many of these press releases are, you know, launching a product by one of our startups. Because if IIT Delhi puts up, you know, these sort of press releases, it immediately attracts, you know, worldwide attention. At the national level, it also receives a lot of attention. And that helps the company to, you know, to actually become a player in that space. If our institutions don't do that, if we shy away from promoting our own startups, the products developed by our own startups, nobody is going to do it for them. Therefore, as an institution, you know, we need to even support them in terms of marketing. And IIT Delhi is doing it very effectively. In fact, every week, you know, whenever a startup wants to launch a product, I tell them, you know, let us put it out as a press release. But when institution is doing that, we have to go through all the approvals. We look at every certification they have got. We make sure that what they are claiming is entirely true. Because if IIT Delhi puts it out and if that particular product is not meeting the claims of that company, then the institution will get a bad name. So we have an internal process in place right now where once we screen it, once we are assured that what the inventors are claiming is actually true, then IIT goes full length and then, you know, helps reach out to people by issuing a press release. All those press releases you will actually find on the IIT Delhi webpage. And, you know, by IIT Delhi giving that, we usually reach out to, you know, a million people right now. And so that is the power of marketing. That is where our institutions can also help it. I think it is a role of educational institutions to promote our startups, and they can promote them in so many different ways. I think that needs to happen. And only, you know, our future lies in our startups. And I think unless our educational institutions support these startups and embrace them, I don't see much future for this country, because I think our students need to become job providers, and that is how the nation will grow. And these startups today will become tomorrow's large companies, and some of them will make this country proud. So thank you very much, and I'll stop.
Wonderful, Professor. So, with your permission, we'll curate some questions from participants, sir.
Thank you. Sure.
Yeah. So, one question I can see from a startup. He says that I'm not from IIT. I belong to a college in Gujarat. Can some kind of virtual mentorship, online guidance, and such kind of things are possible?
Yeah, as I mentioned, IIT Delhi incubator is an open incubator. Anybody can apply. And so if your idea is good, IIT Delhi, you can come and stay on our campus, and we will take care of the rest of it. So we are essentially focusing on the ideas now. So if you can convince that your idea is something innovative, novel, and has enough depth, you know, we will begin. So write to us. The FITT is the body that you need to contact, the Foundation for Innovation and Technology Transfer. If you go to the Google, if you go to Google and search FITT IIT Delhi, you will find all the information about how to contact them. So I encourage you to contact them.
Wonderful. Professor, I see a question from a faculty member. He says that I did a good research. I wanted to take that into product and market, but somehow the local policies and academic systems didn't help you that. So what are the steps that IIT Delhi is taking to see that faculty member can also be part of the startups coming out from the research?
This is a very good point. In fact, you know, faculty entrepreneurship is something which is very, very important to promote. I strongly, you know, believe in that. We launched about a year ago a program called FIRE, FIRE, I call it. And FIRE stands for Faculty Innovation and Research Driven Entrepreneurship. What it basically does is under this FIRE program, now you when a faculty member says, I have a great idea, now I want to start a company with my students, institute gives that faculty member 1 year of sabbatical. So we have now, through our board resolution, we have modified our sabbatical rules. Faculty member can take 1 year sabbatical leave. When I say sabbatical, faculty member is paid salary during that 1 year. And the faculty member can combine that 1 year sabbatical with 2 year lean. So that way 2-3 years total leave a faculty member can take. And institute also gives the faculty member 50 lakh rupees as a grant. So using this money, using the leave, and you know, can a faculty member become an entrepreneur? And but again, it depends on the idea. If the idea is good, all of that will happen. If the idea is not really what we, you know, think is great, then it will not happen. So therefore, if the ideas are good, now institutions need to promote that sort of a entrepreneurship opportunity for the faculty members. I know that many universities don't allow that right now, but UGC, I can tell you, is seriously looking at it. A few months ago, there was a committee formed. I happened to chair that committee. They wanted us to draft policies for universities to, our university faculty to become entrepreneurs. We have submitted that report to them, and we need to follow up on that. So I think what we suggested to them was to follow the policies that IITs have, you know, even in the universities. And that should not be difficult, because I think we are already, all this is allowed in IITs. I don't see any reason why it cannot be done in the, in our universities. I think once that happens, these are the kind of schemes that we should promote. And faculty innovation, faculty entrepreneurship, in my opinion, is very important, you know, for the future of entrepreneurship in this country.
Wonderful. Professor, I have personally had the opportunity to interact with two of your PhD students when you were in IIT Bombay, Nina and others, who created the explosive detection device as a part of their research, and they converted into a company called NanoSleeve. And you know, one of the interesting things Nina says to me is, it was you who made the difference between the choice of going for a postdoc or building a company. So how much it matter for a faculty to motivate their students?
It's very important, but I think if I haven't done that, I cannot tell my students to do it. I think, you know, you have to lead by example. So I always believed that, you know, but initially, of course, you know, when you join an institution, you need to first establish yourself as a researcher. I think you need to have that credibility, you know, in the system. And once you are seen as a good researcher, how many papers you write, 100 papers, 200 papers, 300 papers, at some stage, you know, it stops making any sense to you, and even sense to the people around you. That is when you even start filing patents. How many patents can you file? 10, 20, 30, 40. At some point, people will start asking, you know, what has happened with your patents? So I think, you know, these are all the natural progression. You join an institute, you do research initially, you file patents, and then you want to commercialize some technology, want to focus on more translational kind of problem, identify research areas where you can make a difference in the society. And when all that happens, when you have a solution to that problem, the next step is obviously, you know, doing a startup or an entrepreneurship. And that is where academic institutions need to support these faculty members and students. And I think in IIT now, at IIT Delhi, I would like to see every fifth faculty member, you know, to have their own startup. I think that is a target we have set for ourselves. So if we are 500 faculty, 600 faculty, I would like to see at least 100 startups by our faculty. Because when a faculty member starts a company, there are always invariably, you know, two or three students who are part of that team. And, you know, imagine so many people doing entrepreneurship, working on a real world problem, you know, who have done, where they have found a solution to a problem in the society. I think that will change the culture of our institutions. And I think the faculty-led entrepreneurship is very, very important in my opinion.
Wonderful, sir. In fact, this is a very pragmatic and ambitious both goal that you mentioned. One out of every five faculty of IIT Delhi to part of one startup. And probably that also changes the perspective, how faculty looks research in the perspective, you know, because when a faculty is also part of a company coming out of the lab, then when he come back to the classroom to teach, he brings a new perspective. And I think this phenomenon is quite prevalent in Stanford, in other universities, but somehow, despite we having the world-class researchers, somehow we have little bit missed there. Like, and it is your leadership among all the IITs which actually made the difference in IIT. And you rightly mentioned you want to have hundreds campus startups from the campus. And this is a very ambitious goal. And you have a very concrete plan. How do you start from giving intensive exposure till going to gap year and funding? So that's quite important. And Professor, I think IIT Delhi has demonstrated that. More than 40% of unicorn companies, startup companies belong to your alumni. So that also proves the hypothesis that students have energy and we can leverage that. One suggestion that I can see, Professor, from a participant is you have one of the vast experience as an institution for promoting student entrepreneurship. Do you think in short to medium run to create an online program where you can teach more people across this country on entrepreneurship and handholding them?
Point, we will do that. In fact, the School of Entrepreneurship, which our alumni are coming forward to create at IIT Delhi, you know, will be a school that will offer large number of online programs. You will see more and more of that happening from IIT Delhi. So in fact, we have a very successful minor degree program running here, and we will take it online pretty soon. So that will happen. It's a matter of time, you know, before it will actually happen.
Yeah, one of the participants has suggested that maybe you can open that minor program to also those who are not an IIT, so that they can access to high quality resources and capacity building programs. So that, you know, they can also leverage the same kind of facilities, opening up connections and all these things. Do you also kind of connect to external investment and other networks to help your innovators and entrepreneurs in the campus?
We do that. Our startups are also, you know, I think, you know, that is again where the institutional support is important, because we are connected with so many alumni. IIT Delhi has, 52,000 alumni. And even among our alumni, we have at least 16 unicorn founders. Now, one of the things we recently started doing was getting these unicorn founders addressing our students and our startups. And every month now we have a program where one of these founders comes and, you know, addresses these startups and the students. And also whenever they visit India, you know, we arrange these pitching sessions for startups. In fact, whenever there is a visitor, we take them to the incubator and they talk to the entrepreneurs, and if they like some idea, they even make commitments there. In fact, I also tell these unicorn founders, you know, you can give advices, but I think you also need to be able to write a check at some point, because I think startup founders get lots of advices, but very few people who can write checks. I think I also, you know, tell all our rich alumni that you give advice, but you know, with every advice, or for every 10 advisors, you need to commit certain amount of money. So that is also very important. But one important point I would also like to tell you, you know, in our academic institutions for the past 50 years, we have been seeing, you know, more industry collaborations. Everybody is, you know, telling us to interact more with the industry. Now, startups also act as a bridge between industry and academia. I see that now at IIT Delhi, many industries want to support our startups. But they want IIT to be there in between. So this is a model where institutions, startups, and industry, I think that is now evolving like a nice triangle. And that is also where now our industry interactions are growing very significantly because of the startups. So that is an offshoot of the having a good incubator on the campus.
Wonderful. One faculty member is asking, does this phenomenon of innovation entrepreneurship is tech biased or even non-technology domains has a role to play?
Being an IIT, you know, we would like to focus on technology innovation, particularly the deep tech innovation. And there are AI, ML kind of areas that we are also doing. It's not that when I say deep tech, something has to be a prototype and all that. You know, it's an idea, basically an idea which is solving a problem. And that is all what we are looking at. And there is a technology in everything that we do. So there is, of course, there are companies which are more business model innovation, like the Flipkarts and Snapdeals kind of a thing, where it's more of a business model innovation. But IIT Delhi focuses more on the deep tech innovation.
Wonderful. Professor, you have also been guiding a lot of students and innovators abroad. You have been associated with universities abroad. How do you see the differentiation? Even you are leading one of the top IIT in the country and also seeing innovation entrepreneurship here, laid rather. How do you differentiate? What is the major cultural things that probably we need to make up compared to other academia who are leading innovation entrepreneurship along with research?
You know, I think the university level, we may be doing things right, but the society level, we are lagging behind. In this country today, you know, if you want to do an IT startup, right, the ecosystem exists because there are so many IT companies which are doing very well. You can scale up, you can start an IT company, there are many investors available. All that is now a very natural kind of a process. But deep tech innovation in this country is still a challenge. I have two deep tech startups. I have NanoSniff and SoilSense. It is a struggle. Now, if you are starting a company to build, that explosive detector, a handheld explosive detector, it cannot, you know, get into market with 6 months of research or 1 year of research. It needs 3 to 4 years of intensive effort, and that sort of a thing requires funding. And unfortunately, you know, the VC funding and the angel investments, they're all very short-sighted. You know, many of them are willing to fund an idea which gets into market or which gets them the returns in a shorter time frame, but they're not willing to wait for 3 years or 4 years to invest in these deep technologies. So that ecosystem for deep tech research is missing very significantly in this country. So while in the academic level, we might do all of that right, but I think at the end of the day, somebody needs to invest their money into these enterprises. And there I see a big struggle. But that is again the place where government needs to pitch in. In fact, the government has done very well in the bio area. If you look at the DBT scheme, the BIRAC scheme, right, the big grants and the BIRAC model, which is very successful. In fact, the BIRAC model of funding has enabled so many biotechnology companies to come up in this country. However, actually, you know, I think every ministry in the country needs to start investing in the startups now, needs to allocate some funds for funding these startups, which can help them solve some of their problems. And I think these fund allocation by individual ministries for startups is very, very important. And in the absence of any VC funding, I think only if government pitches in those initial funds and becomes that angel investor, I have a feeling, you know, a lot can change when it comes to the deep tech innovation. So I think for some time, I see a much bigger role for the government until, you know, some of these startups become big. And when they become big, they will also start investing in other startups. You know, so for example, all those Flipkart, Snapdeals, you know, those founders are investing now money in other startups. So they are also help build those kind of startups now. That will happen. But until that happens, I think government needs to take the role of these VCs and angel investors, which are missing, you know, when it comes to the deep tech innovation in this country, which is pretty common in, you know, US particularly has that excellent ecosystem in the Silicon Valley kind of areas. And I think that if you, we can do right in the country, I see a huge potential, you know, for the future growth.
Wonderful, Professor. In fact, to ask one question, which is exactly the point that you mentioned. Professor Praful Varadia, he's head of the Department of Pharmacy College, was saying that for low technology or low hanging fruits, there is an ecosystem. But you rightly mentioned for deep technology, the runway is long. Take more time, you do more tests, you consume more, and then finally it converts into a product and startup. So those kind of ecosystem. But I think your intervention at IIT Delhi about the PhD platform for harnessing deep technology towards that. And that probably will help more and more deep research converting into product and services. But here comes the question which Professor Varadia is asking, Professor, is our research framework APIs are limited to a certain directions like publications and certain factors. Till we don't change those contours, probably it will be difficult to orient our researchers to look that. So what are the KPIs that you think our research framework need to change alter?
You know what, this is a kind of a wrong notion that people have. If you look at my own example, you know, I am a researcher first. I published in all the top journals in my area, and I have become an entrepreneur. But you know, choice of problems is what is important. You might still remain a researcher, but I started choosing problems for the past 15 years. When I look back at my career path, last 15 years, I started choosing problems which have a societal relevance. I chose a problem for cardiac diagnostics. I said, can we build a low-cost detection system for diagnosing cardiac attacks? My other major research effort was detecting a handheld explosive detector which can replace a sniffer dog. My other major research projects were agricultural sensors for detecting NPK in the soil by a poor farmer, you know, at a very low cost, which is, you know, taking into account the economic conditions of the farmer and the, you know, other aspects. Can we develop an NPK sensor or the soil nutrient monitoring? So if you choose your problem right, you can still write top quality papers in all these areas I mentioned, whether it is cardiac diagnosis or explosive detection or electronic nose platform or agricultural sensors. You can write papers in top journals. But if your orientation is out of all this research, I'm eventually looking for building a prototype. I will not stop at just publishing papers or filing patents, but I want to go one step forward and use all the knowledge and all of this work that I have done to finally build a prototype. I know that is entrepreneurship. The entrepreneurship starts where the research ends. Because if you cannot be, you know, writing papers, and then that should not become the end of the whole thing. And that is something which should lead towards entrepreneurship. And that is what I have been doing. In fact, all my research projects now, I don't look at output as publications. Publications, I look at them as byproducts, because the publications anyway will happen, because in our academic institutions, we have PhD students to supervise and they need to publish. You know, if I say that I will not publish any papers, I still want to be in IIT, you know, it doesn't work, because what is my major manpower resource? My manpower resource are basically resources, basically the PhD students, and they need to publish. Now, publications for me at this level may not be very important, but for those students, for them to build their career, publications are important. But therefore, the choice of problems, you need to be very careful. You choose a problem whose end goal is a prototype, and that problem is also very unique, like the kind of problems I mentioned. Then you can actually very well combine research with entrepreneurship, and that becomes much more exciting. You might show 100 publications, but all those 100 publications can come together to demonstrate some products which are of relevance, relevance to the society. So I don't agree that, you know, research and entrepreneurship never go hand in hand. That is a very age-old kind of a thing. And now in modern times, identifying a right problem is the key aspect. And once you identify a right problem, which is unique, which is novel, and then, you know, then you start to find a solution which involves a lot of high-tech research or high-end research, which results in publications. But at the end of the day, if the goal is to build a prototype, that can become beginning of a journey for an entrepreneurship kind of a thing. And I think that is what at least some of the good researchers in this country need to do. So,
wonderful, Professor. You articulated rightly that it's not this or that, this along with that, and keeping product and prototype or a solution as priority, and research and publications will come as a byproduct of that. Probably that perspective will change, because we have more than 5,000 faculty members listening to you today. So this is a new perspective altogether, not going through the publication route, but coming other way.
To add to that, we worked on a program. I was one of the architects of this Impact Imprint program of Government of India, where we clearly wrote the outcome should not be a 2D. 2D is a paper. The outcome should be a 3D. 3D is a prototype. So if you put your goal as a 3D as the outcome, you know, then the publications will happen, but at the end of the day, you also build something which you can come to the, when you go to a review committee, we said, I should not be showing a CV with publication. When I go to a review committee, I bring my prototype and demonstrate that prototype. That is the end goal of my research. You know, that is how the Imprint program is entirely devised, which is inter-ministerial program, which is running very successfully for the past couple of years. I think even the government schemes now need to insist on that. I think, of course, some people need to, you know, I'm not saying that everybody should do this. That is, you know, far from truth. I think the basic research is very, very essential. Today's basic research becomes tomorrow's technology. Therefore, we should never cut down funding for the basic research, and all of that should continue the way it is. But we need to create additional programs, additional avenues for researchers to go beyond just the basic research. For example, you know, even if you look at the gravitational waves, did anybody think that the gravitational waves is applied research? Now, gravitational waves, all those, you know, systems that they are able to build now allows you an additional tool to look at the space. Therefore, now there is a lot of you know, commercial aspect associated with you know, something which is seen as fundamental. Quantum research. Who thought that quantum research is applied? Now, quantum computers today are so important, and everybody is investing billions of dollars to actually build that. So, therefore, there is no distinction between basic research or applied research and all of that. Good research is good research, and good research, you know, can end up in application at some point in time, not immediately, but every research can have an application at some point in time. So therefore, all research should continue. But at least, you know, today the problem is for 95% of researchers in the country, the end goal is a publication. So therefore, the publication count is increasing, but nothing else is happening. So we have become experts at converting, you know, funds into knowledge. So that part we are doing very effectively. The funds to knowledge translation is very good, because even worldwide, if you see, per dollar spent, Indians write more papers than anybody in the world. We actually do better than the Chinese in that respect. But converting that knowledge back to wealth, there we are completely, you know, flat. I mean, we really don't do when it comes to converting that knowledge to wealth. But unless we do that, unless some of us now start to convert that knowledge back to wealth, it is not a sustainable model. We cannot keep on expecting governments to put in more and more money and we file right papers and then everything ends there. I think it cannot survive like that. So that knowledge has to go back and become wealth, and that has to again feed back to the system, and that, you know, needs to be done. And IITs have a major role to play in all of that. And at IIT Delhi, I strongly believe that capability exists. A little bit of reorientation, I'm already seeing that, you know, many faculty members now are coming forward and you know, doing that. Even the COVID has shown us the kind of you know, what an academic institution can do. I think that potential exists. A little bit of orientation, our educational institutions can become the flag bearers of innovation in this country.
Wonderful, sir. In fact, you rightly mentioned, you demonstrated and you also presented some of the use cases of innovation for COVID in IIT. And we also keep reading about your test kit and other from public media. And we wonder, in a month, if such dozens of such innovations can come up, certainly these people, these faculty, the student, the labs have those ability to deliver. But then sometimes we don't feel that urgency, we don't feel that some way, and probably that stops us into it. So, Professor, one question that I can see interesting in this thing is, yeah, this is the case probably that we read through in the public media.
All of this happened in the last 4 months. Whatever we have been talking for the past 50 years has happened in this country. So we suddenly, our research, you know, researchers found relevance, they found focus, there is a team, teams being built, there is an urgency, nationalism, you want to be, you know, solving a problem, the delivery, the industry connect, all of that happened in the last 4 months. And as a result of that, you could see in such a short time what all we could do. I think, you know, that is possible in this country. So that is what COVID has shown. And now our goal is to take it forward and sustain, you know, this momentum.
And you rightly mentioned, Professor, COVID is not a moment, it is a spirit. So the spirit of challenge and spirit of agility probably helps people to think more. And how do you embed that sense of urgency and need? And first time, I think we ran in Gujarat something called Innovate While You Isolate during the isolation and lockdown phase. A call from Student Startup and Innovation Policy from Government of Gujarat. And in a month of a 30 days duration in April, we got more than 700 applications. So I think students are equally responsive in IIT and beyond IITs. But how do we really, as you mentioned, an institutional support system that can be the journey between IIT and market, that is quite important. One question, Professor, with your permission, I will take is, if the research park and other programs, and I'm sure even in this case study situation, how hungry the industries are in terms of supporting any good innovation or enterprise coming out of institutions like ours?
You know, the industry support, I'm sorry, your voice was breaking in between, but I understand what you're saying. So the, you know, 10% of research funding today comes from innovation in many institutions. IIT Delhi, for example, does about 400 crore research every year, 400 to 450 crore. The money that we get from industries on a yearly basis is, 40 to 50 crores kind of thing. And that is where it has been. And 50 years ago, it was still 10%. And even now it is still 10%. So I think, you know, industry funding research to me is one model of research. And but it's, to me, in my mind, it's actually outdated. We are overemphasizing this industry, you know, supporting research and all that. They will put money. They think that it's important for them to, you know, commit that funds to for that particular research. You know, India is known to jump, certain generations. For example, we jump the entire landline generation more to mobile phone. And we might also jump this hybrid auto or the cars and all that. We might jump directly to the electric vehicles. The same thing will happen when it comes to academia-industry collaboration. We pure academic research, then academia collaborating with industry, and then the third model is academia working with its startups. So I think, you know, our model of collaboration with industry will be through the startups. So that is what now is becoming more and more prominent at an institution like IIT Delhi. I see that many companies are coming forward, want to know, you know, what these startups are doing, and they want to invest that money in that startup and have the faculty member as part of the team I think that is how many of these industry collaborations are now taking place in IIT. So to me, that is a new model of collaboration with the industry. I think, which is, in my opinion, a kind of jumping the generation like what the country has done in the other cases. So I see a bright future now. So to me, our future lies in startups. I think the big companies will come in and put that little bit of money, but they will ask too many questions. And now the CSR rules are also a bit liberal. So they are also willing to put in some money. But I think our startups are acting as a bridge between academia and industry. And that model will sustain and scale up. And even from that point of view, I'm a very strong believer in the power of our startups in the future.
Thank you so much, Professor. And one last question I'll put forward, a common question from audience is, in the context of Atmanirbhar Bharat, in the context of more self-sustainable approach, how do you see this innovation and entrepreneurs going to play a role?
I think Atmanirbhar Bharat without without entrepreneurs and innovation, I don't think there's any Atmanirbhar Bharat. I mean, to me, all of this that we have done, if country has become self-reliant in the PPEs, and if country is now ready to export the PPEs, that is because of all these companies which have come forward. And there was a need that was the gap analysis, all what was needed. And I think COVID also brought that to the fore. I mean, COVID showed that what are the things that we need to develop now so that India doesn't need to import. It was a very clear and pointed kind of a thing. So we could solve that problem. I think, once we are able to do that gap analysis, once we are able to figure out this is what we need to do so that, this particular problem will get addressed. There is potential in the country, whether it is startups or industries or academia, that potential exists, but they need to be given those right kind of inputs. I think in this country, if academia is what has succeeded, if you look at ISRO or if you look at any of these agencies, why have they succeeded? DAE, why do you consider ISRO as successful? ISRO has at the end of the day, you build all these laboratories, you have these 10,000 people. At the end of the day, all of that effort needs to come together to fly a satellite. That goal is very well defined. I mean, you cannot say that I join ISRO, what do you do finally? Finally, you have to develop something which goes to that satellite and which goes into the sky. I think that is what is the kind of defining the problem carefully. India has done very well wherever the problems were very well defined. Whether it even in the DAE, we can now build atomic reactors, on our own. And that's because at the end of the day, you join the organization, you have to build an atomic reactor. I think wherever the problems were well defined, India has done exceedingly well. And where the problems were not well defined, we go all over. I mean, we are very innovative people. We get bold also very, very, immediately. So as a result, we go all over and, you don't see anything much coming out of these institutions. Kind of thing. I think that problem setting, goal definition is very, very important for us. And COVID has done that. In the COVID case, we are, government said you are importing all of these. Can you not develop it? And, within 4 months, we could show that you not only can develop it, but you can also export. I think, defining the problem is where we lack right now. That we have always been working in a bottom-up kind of a fashion. I think being a democracy, nobody is supposed to tell me what I am supposed to work on. And, therefore, if there are 600 faculty members, they will work on 500 problems. Everybody is doing something, but, when you look at what has happened, not much has happened. But then you give these, out of these 20 faculty members, you give a very focused problem, give them the funds and tell them in this time frame, this is needed. And, you immediately see all of this happening. I think the top down needs to happen in this country a little bit more. It has to be, it is completely bottom up right now. When DST asks for proposals, they don't tell you, in what area you need to write a proposal. You submit your proposal and then somebody reviews the project and gives you funding. But imagine, in many countries which are developed, there are very thorough analysis, a thorough research done in building writing these white papers and, very, very well documented kind of research problems identified. And then they tell you, this is a problem. Do you have a solution for this? I think, that top down kind of a thing is missing in this country a little bit. And if we can also, and our history shows that, whether it is, like I said, ISRO or DAE, the only difference between them and academic institutions is that goal setting, the problem definition. I think, you know, if that can be done a little bit at the higher levels, I believe, you know, there is a tremendous potential in our academic institutions to innovate and become, you know, contribute to this Atmanirbhar Bharat. I think it's all about, you know, redoing the way we conduct research today.